Nowhere do they have a permanent city, but their future home they also know not. Among them are Scythians, who have ranged from the Donau River toward the rising of the sun. And every chieftain, depending on the larger or smaller number of people subject to him, knows the borders of his grazing land, and knows where he is to graze in the winter, in the summer, in the spring, and in the fall. That is how the Franciscan monk and traveling historian Wilhelm von Rubruck described the life of the Mongolian nomads in his travel journal, Itinerarium Wilhelmi de Rubruck. Since the 20th century, about half the Mongolian population has lived in permanent dwellings, at least most of the time. The other half lives as nomadic herdsmen. The nomadic tribe of the Tsats lives in one of the most isolated regions of Mongolia. To this very day, they have preserved to a great extent a way of life that has been the lot of herdsmen for thousands of years. A journey into the past, a past that has survived in part to this very day, must be undertaken in order to encounter this wandering people. Bordering China and Russia, Mongolia lies deep in the heart of Asia. Its expanse of 1,500,000 square kilometers could easily contain more than half of Western Europe. From Murun, the capital city of the province of Kuvsgul, our journey to the Tsats first takes us into the region of Ulan-Ul, which means Red Mountain. Even the simple fact of undertaking such a journey in this isolated region near Lake Kuvsgul in northwestern Mongolia means risking an adventure whose end is hard to determine. Paved roads and bridges are the exception in this endless, eroded karst landscape. The only orientation help is a good GPS unit, or better yet, a Mongolian guide. Local tradition has it that Mongols are born with an internal compass. At least, that's what they say. But even that provides no protection against unwelcome interruptions to the journey. Even the robust Russian transporters don't manage to make every trip through the rugged territory unscathed. There is a very good reason that an off-road truck is an essential part of every expedition. In light of images like these, it is easy to understand that even today, the Mongolian nomads prefer to depend on their horses to get them from place to place. For them, there is hardly any hindrance that can't be overcome. Horses also don't damage the grazing land that is so critical to raising livestock. Nor do they pollute valuable water sources the way an automobile or truck does when crossing a river. Even worse, knowingly polluting water shows disregard for the local religious belief in the spirits that reside in the waters. The increase in tourism comes as a mixed blessing for the herdsmen. On the one hand, the foreigners bring in much needed money and provide employment for local people. On the other, the visits invariably leave their ecological mark. An automobile can be repaired in a matter of hours. A destroyed pasture takes years to regenerate to the point of being able to support a herd of animals. The skepticism regarding the doubtful influences of the modern world on their life, however, does not keep them from extending special hospitality to visiting foreigners. This contrasts greatly with the Mongols' reputation as a horde of merciless warriors. In reality, hospitality and friendly relationships with their neighbors are the more obvious character traits of the Mongolian nomads. Inviting the foreigner in for a glass of kumis in the ger or the yurt is a matter of course. Kumis is curdled mare's milk. To go with it, they like to serve yogurt and botsok, a type of fried shortbread. Women in the nomad society are free and enjoy equal rights with the men. Mothers are awarded an additional status of special authority, because in addition to their normal daily work, they carry the responsibility of raising the children. A Mongolian saying goes, one is a person from childhood on. About 35 million herded animals populate the country of Mongolia and determine the rhythm of the nomad's life. Horses, sheep, cattle, yaks, goats, reindeers, and camels determine the wanderings through the countryside. The Sum, or district capital of Ulan-Ul, is very thinly populated with only about 3,730 inhabitants. The town looks more like a small settlement, but it provides important supplies and, besides modern medical help, also offers the supernatural healing powers of shamans. Already in the 16th century, explorers reported of ovos, stone heaps which were meant to serve as dwelling places for the local deities. At places like these, shamans call to the spirits and seek their favor. Scientists believe that shamanism probably originated with the indigenous peoples of Siberia. Hoso, or Kumei, is the name given to the Mongolian larynx overtone method of singing. As accompaniment, they play the traditional morin kua, or horse head violin, a two-stringed instrument tuned to harmonic fifths. It's strung with horse hair. The low string is made of 130 hairs from a stallion, while the high string vibrates with 105 hairs from a mare. For the most part, the songs of the herdsmen tell legends of animals that they live with and the land that they travel. Inviting the guest to a festive meal is also part of the tradition of the Mongolian herdsmen. It takes a certain amount of nerve on the part of the modern visitor, however, to stand by and watch a sheep be slaughtered in your honor. The herdsmen insist that the animals suffer the least when they bleed to death internally. So they make a small cut in the belly and with an expert grip tear the main artery, the aorta. This method of slaughter doesn't really look that humane, however. The Mongols are no gourmets. Their food is primarily designed to provide good nourishment for long treks through the endless expanses and to help them survive the normally very harsh winters. Vodka and herbs serve to spice the food. And a milk can also finds use as a cooking pot from time to time. First, it is filled with hot stones. Then, alternating layers of vegetables and meat are laid on the stones. The can serves as a sort of a steamer or crock pot. At the summer campsite, 4 to 5 families herd their animals together. This communal situation serves to distribute the workload and helps the family survive. Slaughtering a single animal to feed several families is simply more economical. But the men should have left the cooking to the women. Even among the Mongolians, they just have a better feel for that. For those with finer sensitivities, a plate like this may not look so appetizing. But with the taste buds numbed by sufficient vodka, even this unusual stew tastes really good. In addition, it provides the energy we will need for the impending journey into the land of the tsats. Menzuim, the shaman, calls on the spirits and asks them for their protection. Before marching into the territory of the tsats, each traveler circles the ovu 3 times to ensure a safe trip. This ancient tradition is common practice for all Mongols. Our expedition takes us into the highlands of the Siberian Taiga plateau in the region bordering Russia. Here in the endless forests on the high plateau live the tsats. These simple natural people are the last Mongolian reindeer nomads and live nearly completely isolated in ancient communal groups. In order to be able to visit them in their trackless homeland, we have to leave our automobiles and mount Mongolian horses. These small but powerful animals are descendants of ancient wild horses that once roamed the eastern steppes. The Mongols maintain a relationship with their horses that is just as close as that which they maintain with their fellow man. Kuleg bolok unagana sa means being a horse from a foal on. So they take very special care in raising the horses. The way you treat your foal determines how well it will serve you as a horse. The Siberian taiga is a land of extremes. In the summer, it can get as hot as 30 degrees Celsius, and in the winter, it is not unusual for temperatures to fall as low as minus 45 degrees. In spite of its elevation of between 512 and over 3,000 meters in some places, rainfall is sparse. The sun shines an average of 300 days per year. In this nearly untouched world, the sight of clear water really means that you can drink directly from the mountain streams with no concern whatsoever. No one pollutes nature here. Not yet. That is why plants and trees grow here that haven't been able to survive in our modern regions for a long time. Scientific studies suggest that mountain gentian, edelweiss, and many other plants that Europeans consider to be local actually originated from Siberia. Only after the last ice age did they become part of Middle European alpine fauna. It is a special honor for the Mongols to journey into the mountain regions. For them, it means entering the home of Genghis Khan. Today, it doesn't matter so much whether they get directly to the Khenti Mountains in the northeastern part of the Republic, or the mountains further to the west. It is said that up here in the mountain heights, the gray wolf, predestined by fate, was conceived from heaven and experienced supernatural protection from his enemies time and again. The reward of our efforts is that we actually encounter tsats and their reindeer here in this rough solitude. Reindeer are common across wide expanses of the globe. Wild herds of many thousands of animals are found from Eurasia all the way to North America. Their unusually long migrations, escaping from the extremes of the Arctic winter, take them over 5,000 kilometers to the south. That resulted in a subspecies, the Siberian forest reindeer, becoming a local inhabitant of the southern taiga. Most of these animals are now domesticated and live with the herdsmen. It is the wandering of the animals that determine the flow of life of the herdsmen, however. In spite of the initial shyness of the children around foreigners, even here among the tsats, who are rarely bothered by civilization, visitors are generally received in a friendly manner. But visitors do not keep them from fulfilling their daily duties as herdsmen. Every day, the female reindeer are brought in from pasture for their daily milking. To assure quick and smooth milking, the feet of the cow are put in shackles. Right after milking, the animal is released back to the pasture. In this case, that is the surrounding open land. It is only used to the extent that its vegetation can regenerate rapidly. The Mongols do not consider land as private property of the individual, but of the entire community. It is not to be carelessly exploited. Their understanding is based not only on a natural understanding of environmental protection, but also the responsibility for the survival of other herdsmen families. The tsats don't find their greatest joy on the backs of their horses, but on those of their very robust reindeer. Even the smallest children learn as early as possible to sit firm in the saddle. That way, they playfully become accustomed to their first duties. Collecting pine cones for heating is one of those duties. Seeds from cones of cedar trees and pine nuts are a well-loved complement to the otherwise monotonous herdsman's diet. Cedar nuts, for example, are considered to be holy by the tsats. As seeds from a tree, they are the offspring of a living entity that is related in broader terms to mankind. The nuts are also very good for one's health, however. That has been proven by scientists at the Tomsk University. The children probably don't care much about how healthy the nuts are. They just taste great. And when they return, their rambunctious activity will confirm to the adults that they have been eating something that is good for them. The main thing is that there are enough empty pine cones left over for heating. It is often the case that knowledge important to the survival of natural peoples gets passed on in playful ways. Visitors are arriving. One of the oldest Mongolian women alive is visiting the camp. She is said to be 100 years old and is a famous shaman. In spite of her age, she has ridden from the old campsite through the harsh mountain landscape to get here. Her presence is no coincidence. She is the first of many from the community of several families who congregate here in the fall camp of Namarya. 4 to 5 families will spend the later summer months here to prepare themselves for the winter. Namarya is a transition stop from the summer camp to the winter campsite. The area surrounding the camp must provide the animals with abundant food so that they can build up as much fat as possible for the winter. So the camp is located in the midst of succulent pasture land. Stop. To live in such close harmony with the reindeer and learning to trust the animals from childhood on means trusting them even with a small baby. But even if the little tsat should fall from the reindeer, he is well protected. A stable bed formed out of wood protects the child from serious injury. In contrast to the steppe nomads, the tsats do not spend the summer living in yurts, but in teepee-like gairs. The reason lies in the short intervals between moves. The reindeer must change grazing land often because in the highlands, grass and bushes grow back more slowly than in the lower-lying steppes. So an otor, or breaking camp, must take place more often for the tsats than for the steppe nomads, and it must be possible with significantly less effort. A teepee is set up in just a few hours. Even in the summer, nights get cold at an altitude of 2,500 meters. Sudden changes in the weather can also not be avoided. So a stove in the center of the tent is one of the few modern commodities that have become a basic necessity. Even this solution is thought out in a very economical way. Where the cooking fires burn, the warmth is effectively captured to heat the rest of the dwelling. The final touch of comfort is provided by warm furs and blankets to sit and lay on. For the tsats, the milk from the reindeer cow replaces that of the mare for the steppe nomads. Similar products are made from both. The tsats also like to put a bit of reindeer milk in their traditional tea. Mongolian tastes and traditions can probably be traced to influences of tribes who originated in what is now the People's Republic of China. Mm-hmm. In spite of their relative isolation, the Tsats maintain contact to the outside world. Under Russian rule, the culture of the nomads was nearly wiped out. Over generations, the people became accustomed to amenities such as tea, salt, and sugar. In contrast to the standards of most Western countries, the Tsats have a merciless attitude toward the aged. If one no longer has the strength to get to the table alone, one does not get anything to eat. The right to life ends for those who can no longer survive on their own. When it is time to slaughter a reindeer in honor of the guests, the weakest of the animals will always be chosen. The Tsats use a method of slaughter than the method used by the steppe nomads. The chosen reindeer is knocked out with a blow to the back of its head. It is over for the animal in a fraction of a second. It doesn't feel the sharp wooden stake pierced directly into its heart. The final trembling is a physical reaction of nerves and the heart as life ebbs from the animal. The animal will never be gutted and dressed until it lies perfectly still at the herdsman's feet, and he is certain that the spirit of the animal has arrived in the next world. Besides meat and milk, the reindeer also provides fur, leather, and bones. Slaughtering the animals is men's work. For them, killing an animal is a thing of normal daily survival. Work distribution in the family follows a clear assignment of tasks. Thus, each member becomes a specialist in his or her own area. The one who bakes the bread is also always the best baker. In this case, the task falls to the women. Nomad families normally eat a warm meal only once a day in the evening. During the summer months, it is not usual to eat meat. The herdsman gets sufficiently full on the milk products anyway. Beginning in the fall, however, meat is a regular part of the menu. At that time of year, there is less danger of getting sick on spoiled meat, and the nomads build up body weights to help them get through the coming winter. If animals are slaughtered during the summer, it is in order to produce enough dried meat to get through the winter and to trade with in the Sum capital city. To observe the simple lifestyle of the Tsats, with their many customs and traditions from past ages, is to participate in living history. In the 6th century, the Chinese first mentioned the tribal peoples, referring to them as Mengwu or Menggu. In those days, they lived between the Great Wall of China and Lake Baikal in the region of the Onon, Kerlen, and Tuol rivers. Even then, one tribe was distinctly different from the other. In the first literary work about the Mongols, Secret History of the Mongols, forest tribes and steppe tribes are mentioned. The more highly developed steppe nomads envied the forest dwellers their relative freedom, because they were not bound quite as tightly to the tasks of raising their animals. At the same time, the forest nomads were aware of their freedom. For example, when they needed to discipline a rebellious daughter, they would threaten to give her away in marriage to a man with horses and herds of sheep. In light of the escalating environmental problems all over the world, perhaps the lifestyle of the Tsats was the right choice, and the civilized world would do well to take a few tips from them. Among those tips would surely be the method of tanning hides and treating furs entirely without the help of chemicals. For the Tsats, complete utilization of resources means that even the antlers of the slaughtered reindeer are put to good use. Attractive carvings are made from the antler material, and sold for lucrative prices on the markets of the Sum capital cities. Among other things, the men trade their goods for hunting weapons. They make the task of providing food for their families more effective and, as strange as it may seem, provide a relatively humane means of killing the wild animals quickly and unexpectedly. The herdsmen need to hurry now. A change in the weather announces the approach of colder temperatures. It's time to gather firewood. Within just a few hours, the late summer has turned into harsh winter up here in the highlands. It is not unusual for the temperature to suddenly fall from a comfortable plus 20 degrees Celsius to a very cold minus 20 degrees. But even such events are taken in stride. Nature determines what needs to be done and when. That's just the way it is. The blows of the axe echoing through the taiga is like the ringing of the bells announcing the coming of winter, which begins already in September at this altitude. The animals follow their instincts and use the remaining opportunities to really stuff themselves full. The approaching months will be a time of deprivation for both man and animal. For the winter, the herdsmen will now move to the Uvulyu, the winter camp. They will spend the hard times here encouraged by their statement of faith, heaven and earth increase our strength. They are confident that Tengger, their heavenly deity, will protect them through the winter.